All right, so welcome everyone. Good evening. Waiting for everybody else to join in. Okay. By the way, when you joined the meeting, did it ask for the registration or something? They ask you about your email IDs, name. Okay. Required for your attendance, actually, probably. So I'm waiting for others to join in quickly. So just a minute and then we'll start. Have you guys done the homework already? The workbook I have shared and the assignment that I had given. Anybody tried that? Not the PDF. Okay. Yet. So, you know, the trick is this only, that you move with the class, you do a chapter in such a manner that you don't have to go back to that chapter again, ever. Fine. So that way you'll be very confident moving forward. And you'll not waste time reading the chapter again. So you, without doing chapter number one properly, you move on to chapter number two, you'll see that you'll keep on coming back to chapter number one. And then chapter number, when you get in chapter number three, you'll keep on going to chapter number one and two. So don't do that to yourself. Work hard. And at least at the start, you should really, really work hard, because that will give you a lot more confidence. Okay. Fine. Still few are not there. Just few more seconds, we'll wait. Yes, what happened, Aruno? What do you want? You tell me what you want. Okay, then we'll tell. Sir, I was not getting many questions, so should I do all the questions I can do and then come back to the hard ones? If you only do the question which you can do, you're not learning anything. You already know how to do them and you have done them. So what new you have learned? Okay. So if you are struggling with a question, you're not able to do it yourself, discuss with your friends, put it on the group, do everything that is possible, and then say that, okay, I'm not getting it. It should not be that, okay, first time you tried, you're not able to solve it. All right, let's move ahead to the next question. Then you're wasting your time. Okay, so struggle through the question if you're not able to get it. Understood? All right, guys, so today we will continue with the kinematics, as in the motion in one dimension. All right, so last session we had started motion in 1D, and motion in 1D was the first chapter of kinematics, wherein we have discussed the basic the variables which we should be using to track the motion and analyze the motion. Fine. Like, for example, the displacement, velocity, acceleration, speed, distance, all these things we have learned. And the most important variable was time. Okay. So we have learned these variables, and then these variables can be put on a graph as well. So we can say x-axis is time, y-axis is displacement, or x-axis is time, y-axis is acceleration. right? So all of that we have done. So we have analyzed the situation graphically. We have seen different kinds of scenario, how it looks on a graph, all right? And then we have also understood that same situation we can analyze by using the kinematics equations, right? These kinematics equation, that is V is equal to U plus AT, S equal to UT plus half AT square, and other two equations. These equations are valid only for special scenario where acceleration is constant, right? Right. So we have learned, about these constant acceleration equations of motion. Fine. And we have solved a lot of questions on it, and we have understood that the one very common example of constant acceleration is when object is moving under the influence of only gravity, right? So this is what we have done in the previous class. Now in today's session, we are going to discuss few more cases which can be analyzed graphically, because graphical analysis is not yet over. Then we will learn one of the most important tool of kinematics, which is the calculus. Okay, so I assume that Akhil might have introduced to you a little bit of calculus, and only that much is required in physics. You don't need to be a master of calculus. Okay, basics of calculus is enough. So we are going to discuss how calculus will help us to analyze a situation in which acceleration is not constant, right? And once I know that how to analyze a motion in which acceleration is not constant, I can analyze any situation, isn't it? Because the equations of motion are restricting us to analyze only those motions which have constant acceleration. Now calculus will help you to analyze the motion in which acceleration is not a constant. It can be anything, it can vary. So then you have been now given a free hand. Once you know the calculus, you cannot say that this question is out of my curriculum. Everything under the sun comes under your curriculum now, especially in competitive exams, fine? And then we'll be discussing about the relative motion, okay? How the motion will appear to a person who himself or herself is moving, right? So these are the agendas of today's class. So we'll be taking it up one by one, all right? Aja, by the way, what was the last thing we have done in the last class? Anybody remembers last thing in the last class, what we have done? Elephant question we have done. Okay, distance traveled in the nth second. All right. Okay, so let's proceed. So there are few graphical scenarios that are pending from my side. So let us discuss them. The first one is graph between acceleration and time. Write down. Fine. So let us see how the graph, I mean, what does the acceleration time graph tells us, okay? So this is a simple graph. Let's say I'm taking a constant acceleration graph. On the x-axis, I have time. On the y-axis, I have the acceleration, okay? Now, when I'm plotting the graph of constant acceleration, how does it look like, everyone? Constant acceleration graph, how does it look like? Straight line parallel to time axis. Correct. Parallel to time axis, which is the x-axis. So this is the constant acceleration. Getting it? Now, what I'm trying to do is, I'm trying to understand what are the various things related to graph? Is there a physical meaning to it? Fine. And there are only two things in any graph in kinematics. What are these? First is slope. What is the second thing? Anyone? Slope and area. Only two things. Okay. Slope is zero. Zero slope means that acceleration is constant. Okay. So what does area represent? Area of this graph. What does it represent? All of you, try doing it. It's a rectangle, right? This much distance is what? This much is the amount of time it is taking, let's say T naught, and this much is A. So area is what? Area is 80, right? So area is small a into t, and it is a constant acceleration case. It's a constant acceleration case. So I know that v is equal to u plus at. All right. From here, at comes out to be v minus u. So area of acceleration time graph is change in velocity. Okay. But then we have proved it only for the constant acceleration, right? What if the situation is like this? This is the complete graph, let's say. Okay, this is, let's say, complete graph. This is, let's say, A1 area. This is A2 area. Okay, so what I can say about A1 minus A2? Difference in areas. One area is above the time axis, taken as positive area. One area is below the time axis, I'll take it as negative area. So I'm adding the two areas. So what it should be? Anyone? Acha, let's say velocity over here is u. This is u velocity over here, v1, over here it is v. Okay, so a1 is what? A1 is v1 minus u, right? And a2 basically is a positive quantity, but there's a deceleration there. So actually at is negative there, right? So that is a minus a2 I'm writing here. Minus a2 is what? V minus v1. This area is final velocity minus initial velocity before this acceleration started. All of you understand? Right? So A1 minus A2, if I add these two equations, I will get A1 minus A2 to be V minus U. Okay, so even if there are multiple accelerations which are constant in a graph, then also the area under the graph should be equal to final velocity minus initial velocity. Okay, now what if the acceleration is changing, then what it will be? Let's say this is a situation. A and T, okay? Let's say this is how acceleration is changing, all right? Now I want to find out what does this area represents? Anyone? Anybody knows? What is the area under velocity time graph is? Area under VT curve is what? Everyone. Area under VT curve is displacement, right? It is displacement. Whether area, whether the velocity is constant or not, right? So we have proved it for constant velocity. Now, if velocity is changing, then how did we prove that? How did we prove that even if velocity is variable, area will be the displacement? How did we do that? What is the proof? We have considered small strips, correct? So we are going to consider small strips like this. Okay, so if I consider this small strip, this strip thickness is very, very less. This thickness, let me call it as DT. Okay, can I say that for this very small thickness, acceleration is constant? Can I say that for this small strip only? Everyone. Right? So area of this strip is, let's say, dA. Okay, dA is A into dt. Let's say from distance of from here to there is A. This is A. Okay, so dA is A dt. All right. Now, since the thickness is very, very small, this ADT is also equal to change in velocity between this point and that point, right? Because the acceleration is constant. We just proved that for constant acceleration, area is change in velocity between final and initial point. My final and initial points are within a width of DT. So ADT is equal to DV, and ADT is the small area also. Okay, so when I integrate, so I'll get dA is equal to dV. So this is equal to that. Getting it? So when I integrate, my limits will go from, when I am here, my area covered is zero. When I'm there, total area is A. Initial velocity U, final velocity V. So I'll get total area still to be equal to V minus U. Okay. So whether the acceleration is constant or not, it does not matter. Area under acceleration time graph is final velocity minus initial velocity. Okay. Which part, Pradyun? Did you guys not do the definite integral? You guys are seeing it for the first time, U and V, when I'm writing like this. Okay, you did only indefinite. So Pradyun, hold on then. We are going to discuss the integral anyways. A little bit discussion we'll have. So how to do definite integral, you'll understand. There's nothing, very complicated here. You'll understand when I will teach you a little bit about definite integral, okay? All right, guys. So let's quickly get into the calculus in kinematics. Because that is more relevant, and Arnav, test is on 14th. All of you know this, right? Test is on 14th. Everybody. Okay. So guys, write down this thing, calculus. In kinematics. Okay. Now, calculus in kinematics, you guys already know a little bit. Okay. So, for example,
just give me a second.
Isn't this a calculus equation that velocity is equal to ds by dt? What is this? A differential equation? Have you guys seen this equation before? V is equal to ds by dt. V is equal to ds by dt. Now tell me, when this equation is valid for constant acceleration or any type of motion, V is equal to ds by dt. What do you think? V equal to ds by dt is valid for every type of motion or only constant acceleration? Correct. It is, I don't know, once only, okay? You guys reply only once. One person, one time. So this equation is valid for every or for any type of motion. Okay. And what else you guys know? Anything else? Any other equation you guys know? Correct. A is equal to dv by dt. Even this is valid for any type of motion. Okay. Yes. Okay. So these are there. Now, these are the founding stones of the calculus in the kinematics. All right. Now, this will give you velocity. What about speed? How do you get speed? Let's say I want to find speed. What is the equation for speed? Distance by time is average speed. Then velocity is displacement by time according to that definition. Give me a differential equation like we are given velocity ds by dt. So u is what? Correct. You have to differentiate the magnitude of the displacement. Okay, magnitude. You don't care about the change in direction with time. You only care about the change in the magnitude of the displacement. So that's why you need to differentiate the magnitude of the vector, not the total vector. Getting it? We'll be taking up a lot of numericals, examples. You'll understand how to use all of this. Okay. Right now, just write it like a theory. Okay. Now there is one more very important differential equation, which is like this. Okay. So acceleration is written as dv by dt. So right now you are writing acceleration as a function of velocity and time. Okay. Now, if you multiply and divide by the ds vector, like this, okay, you'll see what you'll get. You'll get ds by dt, I'm rearranging the term, into dv by ds. Now what is ds by dt? Ds by dt is velocity. So acceleration can be written as v dv by ds. Okay. Now acceleration is written as a function of velocity and displacement s. All right. How is a vector? A is acceleration, right? Ansh, A is acceleration. It's a vector quantity. Okay. Now this is the differential equation. These are the differential equations which are always true. Now, but then these differential equation will tell you what is ds, what is dt, what is ds by dt, what is dv by dt. This equation, for example, A is equal to dv by dt. This will not tell you what is v. This will only tell you what is dv by dt. So how to find v from here? To find v, you have to integrate. Okay, you have to integrate. All right, so now you'll see how integration will be used here. So for example, is audio lagging, everyone? Is my audio lagging? No, it is not lagging. Yeah. I'll take a poll. Is my audio lagging? Is there a lag in the audio? Okay, so you can see there is no lag in the audio. Those who are experiencing the lag, log out and immediately log in. Okay. Fine. So, what I was saying that you need to integrate to get the value of velocity from this equation. So how to integrate it? So dv can be written as a dt like this. Okay. And then you have to integrate this. All right. What is the integral of dv? Anyone? Integral dv is what? Integral of dv. I don't know. Okay. Do you guys know integral of dx? This is how much? Okay, remember, integral of anything like this is a variable itself. Okay, so you guys remember this? Integral of this is x. So integral of dv is v. Okay, integral of dv is v. Fine. Now, what is the integral of a dt? A into t. Yes, there will be a constant also. Correct. Plus c will be there, but I'm not putting it right now. I'll tell you why later on. So integral a dt, will you be able to integrate a dt integral just like that? A need not be constant. Acceleration a need not be constant. Will you be able to integrate a dt? Everyone, we cannot, please write down, we can't integrate with two variables. What are the two variables? A and T. Okay, so if A would have been constant, what will happen to A? If it would have been constant, what will happen to A? A will come out of integral. A will come out of integral. You can write A outside the integral, and then integral dt will be t. Okay. Else, if A is not constant, if A is not a constant, you write A in terms of T, then only you can integrate it. Otherwise, you cannot integrate integral of A dt. Okay, so I'll repeat myself again with an example. All of you, listen here. There is no hurry, okay? I'm not going to rush. This is the first time you are seeing the use of calculus in physics, everyone. So what I'm trying to say is that integral a dt, you'll not be able to integrate unless you know what is a, okay? So if a is constant, a will come out of integral and this integral will become integral of a dt and it will become a t chalo plus constant c. Okay, this is what you guys have learned, right? And if a is not a constant, for example, a is given like this, a is t minus 2t square. This is how a is changing with time. Then you need to put the value of a there, and instead of a, you'll write t minus 2t square into dt. Okay, then you'll open the brackets, it'll become integral t dt minus 2 will come out because 2 is constant, integral of t square dt. So what it will be equal to, everyone? Integrate t dt is what? You guys know the formulas? You don't know the formulas? Are okay, few of you know it. I'll just write down the list of formulas that you must know at least for today. Okay? And majority of the time in physics, you're going to use these formulas only. Everyone, integral of x n dx. I think it is done, isn't it? Anyways, all of you write down. There is a constant also, plus c. I'm not writing plus c. Okay, so these are the few formulas that you should know, and whatever other than this formulas are required, I will tell you as the time progresses. Okay. Sir, if we only got a list but we don't know any questions, I mean, you're doing the questions now, right? This is the list, you have to use this. Now integrate t dt, which formula should you use? Which one? First one or second one, third one? Which one? The first one, what is the value of n there? Instead of x, t is there and n is equal to 1. So it will become t to the power 1 plus 1, which is t square, divided by 1 plus 1, which is 2. So t square by 2, integral t dt. Okay? Right? So this is t square by 2. What about this? How much this will become? Everyone, minus of 2t cube by 3. All right, 2t cube by 3 and plus constant because you're dealing with the indefinite integral. Okay, so now you understand you'll not be able to integrate anything under the sun. So for example, x dy, you cannot integrate it unless we write, unless you write x in terms of y, you can't integrate this. You cannot integrate. Fine. So remember this. Okay. Now I'll tell you what is definite integral. Okay, definite integral. These are indefinite integral wherein a constant will come in the expression. Fine. So definite integral is simple straightforward extension of indefinite integral. It is not it is not completely new. Okay, so what it says is that if integral of fx dx is gx, okay, integral of fx gx dx is gx. Example is integral of x dx is x square by 2. So fx is what? If you compare these two, fx is what? X, gx is x square by 2. All right? If this is true, the limits, if you write x1 to x2, so it will be x1 to x2. Once you get gx, you have to write it as x1, x2 like this. X1 and x2. What are x1 and x2? X1 and x2 are the points between which you are integrating. You are not integrating till infinity. I am only interested to integrate between initial point and final point. So I'll write what is the value of x initially and what is the value of x finally. So these are x1 and x2. Okay, so this will be equal to gx2 minus gx1. So how to put the limits? It will be x2 square by 2 minus x1 square by 2. And because you're subtracting, constant goes off. Constant will not be there if you put limits. So is it clear to everyone? Everyone is clear? Quickly type out. We'll be taking a lot of questions anyways. Is it 60 to 70% clear? We'll be taking up questions. Don't worry. Okay. So let's take a question quickly. All right. So what I'm saying is the velocity is given as 2t minus 3t square meter per second. This is the velocity given to you. Okay. You need to find displacement. How much is the displacement? How much is the displacement between t equal to 1 seconds and t equal to 2 seconds? Between these two time periods, what is the amount of displacement we are having? Okay, and whenever I'm writing these equations, I'm assuming it is motion in 1D, because chapter is motion in 1D. Everything is under that. Object is going in a straight line. Okay, so don't worry about some angles and components. Do it, everyone. Okay, two people have answered already. Everybody else? Okay, people are getting different answers. Okay, how will you proceed here, everyone? How will you proceed? Is acceleration constant or not? Everyone, can you tell me acceleration is constant here? Is acceleration constant? How to find acceleration? How to find acceleration? Velocity is given to you. Acceleration is dv by dt. How much it comes out to be? how much is acceleration? 2 minus 60. So you can see acceleration is not constant. You cannot use equations of motion. Then how to get the displacement? What is the relation between velocity and displacement? Velocity is dx by dt. Why I'm using x? Because everything is happening in one dimension. So I'm calling that displacement in terms of x coordinate. Okay. So dx will be equal to v dt. Okay. What I have to find out? Displacement. Right. So I'll integrate what? X. Because I want to find what is the value of x. This I'll integrate. And that I'll integrate. Okay. Limits will be for x. What is the limit? Initial location is what? Initial x location is 0. And time is what? T is equal to what? At x equal to 0. At x equal to 0, what is time? 1 second. Then at x equal to x, t is 2. So I will get the value of x between 1 and 2 if I put the limits like this. That is the only difference between definite and indefinite integral. Okay. Everything else remains same, formulas and everything. So from here, integral dx is x. Limit goes from 0 to x. V is 2t minus 3t square dt integral 1 to 2. Okay. So the value of x is equal to 2t dt integral is t square 1 to 2. 3t square dt is t cube 1 to 2. Right. So it will be 2 square minus 1 square. For the first, this is t square limits 1 and 2 minus 2 cube minus 1 cube. Right. So the value of x will come out to be 2 square minus 2 cube, which is 4 minus 8, that is minus 4 meters. Now go through this question and let me know whether you have understood it or not. You can ask me any doubts, everyone. I didn't get the last step. What? What is the issue there? This is 2 integral t dt minus 3 integral t square dt. So what is t square dt integral? T square dt is what? T cube by 3. Right? So 3 will go away. Then t dt integral is t square by 2. 2 will go away. Okay? You have to do it yourself. If you just copy it, you will not get anything. Okay. All right. So any other doubt? Anyone? Anyone has any other doubt? How did t square becomes t? Are you, this is what we have done. Na? This is this one. See this. Gx2 minus gx1. Whatever you get after integral, you have to put upper limit, that is 2 minus 2. You have to put, instead of t, you have to first put t and then minus, then put 1. So 2 square minus 1 square. Here it will be 2 cube minus 1 cube. Upper limit, lower limit. That is what we have done here. Clear? Any other doubt, anyone? Anybody else? All of you have understood, please type in yes or no. Then I'll proceed. Okay, fine. So looks like everybody understood. There are few more formulas which not sure whether you guys know it. It need not be just sine x. It can be sine kx. What is the integral of this? Anybody know this already? Minus 1 by k cos kx plus constant. Okay. The constant will come in the denominator. Integral of cos kx dx. This will be equal to 1 by k sine kx plus c. Okay. So these are the few formulas which could be handy. All right. And you will anyway be remembering it. You will be solving so many questions that you will tend to remember all of this. All right. Now take another question, all of you. Since we are learning it for the first time, we should take a lot of questions on it. What is given is acceleration is t minus t square. Okay. Initial velocity of an object is 2 meter per second. We need to find what is the final velocity. Okay. In the t equal to 3 seconds. In 3 seconds, if initial velocity was 2 meter per second, what is the final velocity? Everyone. Okay. Anybody else? I got two answers. All of you, quick. Try it out. I mean, you may not get the correct answer. It is all fine. It doesn't matter how many of you are able to solve it, how many are not able to solve it. Okay. These are just for the practice. All right, so let's do it now, everyone. Now here clearly, you know, acceleration is a function of time. All right, so it is not constant. Again, I cannot use equations of motion here. So what I'll do is that I'll write acceleration as dv by dt. And this is equal to t minus t square. So dv can be written as t dt minus t square dt. Okay. So when I integrate this, I'll write like that. Limits. What will be the lower limit for velocity? What should I write here? Lower limit. At t equal to 0, what was the velocity? Velocity was 2. Then at t equal to 3 seconds, let's say velocity is v. T is what? Lower limit t is what? 0, right? It starts from t equal to 0, then goes to 3. 0 to 3. Like that. Okay? Integral of dv is v. Then you have to put a line like this. Write down lower limit, upper limit. This is equal to integral of t dt is what? Everyone, t square by 2, right? Limits are from 0 to 3. Minus integral t square dt is t cube by 3. Limits are from 0 to 3. Like this. Now, what should I write here on the left hand side? What should I write? Everyone. Aditi, what should I write here? Correct. Upper limit minus lower limit. Instead of V, I'll write upper limit and then lower limit. T square by 2. What should I write here? Upper limit 3 square by 2 minus lower limit 0 square by 2. Instead of T, you have to put the upper limit. Okay, instead of T. Instead of T, you have to write 3. So it is 3 square by 2 minus 3 cube by 3 minus 0 cube by 3. So 0 is 0, right? So 0 cube doesn't change anything. So velocity, I'll just tell you the final answer now. Velocity will be minus of 5 by 2 meter per second. Okay, so when you simplify this, you'll get that. Don't make any silly errors here. Fine, so this is the answer for the velocity. Okay, one more question is this. Acceleration is given as sine of pi t by 2. This is acceleration. Clearly, it is not constant. It fluctuates as a sine function. Okay. Initial velocity is 0. You need to find final velocity in 1 second. In 1 second, how much will be the final velocity? Look at the formula above. You have to use a formula above. You don't need to convert in degrees. As long as you know what is sine of pi by 2, what is sine of pi and all those, you already know. Why you need to convert in degrees? No. Sine of pi by 2 is what? Everyone? 1, right? Sine of pi by 2 is 1. And cos of pi by 2 is 0. Okay, so you know what it is. You don't need to convert in degrees. In fact, the radians is the SI unit. You convert degrees into radians in physics, not otherwise. But then till now you have been learning degrees. So that's why you're comfortable with the degrees. Everyone, how should I solve it? What should I write A as? Okay, I'm waiting. All of you tried? Arabi, what should I write A as? Arabi. A should be written what? dv by dt is A. This you write it as sine of pi t by 2. Okay. So dv is equal to sine of pi by 2 t dt. Now you can integrate. Integration can be done only in one variable. You can see left hand side the variable is v, right hand side variable is t. So now you can integrate. Okay. So velocity initial is 0, final is let's say v, time is 0 to 1. Okay. So you'll get v is equal to integral of sine pi by 2 t is what? Minus of 2 by pi cos of pi t by 2 0 to 1. Okay. So minus of 2 by pi. First I will put t is 1. So cos of pi by 2 minus cos of, then put t equal to 0. This one. Cos of pi by 2 is 0. So you will get velocity as 2 by pi meter per second. Okay. Everybody understood this question? All of you? Arabi, are you getting it? Okay. Let's take one last question. Minus 2 by pi, why? See here, there, this is 0, minus of cos 0 is minus 1. So minus 1 into minus 2 by pi becomes plus 2 by pi. But if you make such silly error, there will be one option which says minus 2 by pi. And you'll mark it, you'll not get 0, you'll get minus 1. Okay, so be very careful. All right, now let's say acceleration is 2x. Acceleration is 2 times x. What is given here is that at x equal to 2 meters, at x equal to 2 meter, velocity is given to you. Velocity is 2 meter per second. Okay, then at x equal to 10 meters, final velocity will be what? Okay, this is the last question on calculus as illustration. Solve it. What do you write A as? Should I write A as dv by dt? What should I write A as? If you write dv by dt as A, what is the problem? The problem is you are unnecessarily introducing time variable. So dv is equal to 2x dt. You will not be able to integrate the right hand side first, and you don't know the limits for the time t. Limits for x you know. So this won't help you. Okay. So you should write a as v dv by dx, which we have learned. V dv by dx, right? So you can see here where it went over here. So we are using this one, function of velocity and displacement, acceleration. Okay. So v dv by dx will be equal to 2x, right? So from here, v dv is equal to 2x dx. Then you integrate this. Lower limit for velocity is what? What should I write limits for the velocity? Two to v, right? And for x, x will go from where to where? 2 to 10. It is written, it goes from 2 to 10, where velocity goes from 2 to final velocity. Okay, so I will get it as v square by 2. The limits are 2 and v. This will be 2 into x square by 2. This one. So from here, v square by 2 minus 2 square by 2 is equal to 10 square minus 2 square. Clear to all of you? So v square is equal to 2 times of 10 square minus 2 square plus 2 square. So velocity is velocity is root over same thing. I'll not be calculating it. This is what. So you simplify it, you'll get the answer for the velocity. Now when you take a square root, you get plus and minus. Which one will you take? Or both are correct? You'll get plus minus, right? When you take square root. Will you keep positive or negative, or both are correct? You keep both. Why? Acha, tell me. Initial velocity is in positive direction or negative direction? Initial is positive. Acceleration is positive throughout 2 to 10. Acceleration is positive throughout or not? Acceleration is positive throughout. So how can velocity become negative? Right? Velocity will keep on increasing, isn't it? All right. So, just one more question, because this is important. Acceleration is given as 6 times t. Okay, it is given as 6 times t. You need to find out the displacement x between 0 and 1 seconds. A is given and I am asking you to find the displacement x. What you should do here? What you should do here? Acceleration as a function of time is given, but what do you want? What do you want? You want velocity as a function of time, isn't it? All of you, you need velocity as a function of time, then only you'll get displacement, correct? So how to get velocity as a function of time? You have to integrate it two times, okay? Acceleration is given as dv by dt. This is equal to 6t, okay? From here, dv is equal to 6t dt. So when I integrate this, my initial velocity should be given here. Actually, I'm assuming initial velocity to be zero. It need not be zero, okay? I'm assuming it to be zero for sake of simplicity. So whatever the initial velocity, come here. Initial velocity is zero, okay? Final velocity, let's say, is v. V is a velocity at any time t. So that is why upper limit is v, lower limit is zero, because initial velocity at t equal to zero, I am assuming it to be zero, and it need not be zero. So t equal to zero and t equal to t. So from here, you will get v is equal to 6 into t square by 2, or you will get 3t square. This is the velocity as a function of time. V is equal to 3t square. Now I'll write v as dx by dt. This is equal to 3t square, right? From here, dx comes out to be 3t square dt. Integrate this. Limit goes from 0 to 1. X initially is 0, and then whatever it is, x. X will come out to be t square dt is t cube by 3. When you put limit, you'll get x equal to 1. Okay, so this is how you solve this type of question. Okay, fine. So I hope you guys are now reasonably sure. You cannot, be 100% sure just by solving few questions that you're done with it. No. Okay. But then at least if you guys now think that if you do enough practice, you'll get a hang of it, then that is what is required as of now. So let's proceed forward. There is one more graph between acceleration and displacement. Write down. Graph between A and X. So, let's first take a constant acceleration case. This is X and this is A, okay? There is a constant acceleration case, right? You need to tell me, what does this area represent? Slope is zero, right? Zero slope means acceleration is constant. What does this area represent? Think over it. Area is A naught X naught. It's a constant acceleration, right? So which equation of motion you see the multiplication of acceleration with displacement? v square equal to u square plus 2ax. That is valid here because it is a constant iteration, right? So if you see here, v square equal to u square plus 2ax, a naught x naught should be equal to final velocity square minus initial velocity square divided by 2. So graphically, this is what the area under the AX graph implies. Okay, and if it is like this, let's say this is A1 area, this is A2 area, then A1 minus A2, even this is equal to final velocity square minus initial velocity square divided by 2. It is valid. You know, graphically things are much more stronger. You can directly get it as this. If you try to do it using equation, you need to first write down the equation for the case number one when excitation is constant, then second case when excitation is constant, and then solve the two equation. But graphically it is very strong. Just find the area. Total area is final velocity square minus initial velocity square divided by 2. Okay. What if excitation is changing with x? Then what will happen? Till now, whatever happens with the constant acceleration, same thing used to be true for the variable acceleration also, right? Will it be true this time also or not? This is A, this is X, let's say, all right? And this is how acceleration is changing. So what does the area represent? Think over it. Yeah, make a rectangular strips. The method will remain the same. Every time we'll be doing the same thing. So if I take a strip like this, a small strip, got it? Then I can say that since the strip thickness is very less, a acceleration is constant, okay? The thickness is dx. Acceleration is, let's say, A. So area is what? Area is A dx. This is a small area. Okay. This should be equal to, this should be equal to change in velocity across this square by 2. So this will be equal to d v square by 2. Okay. So total area when you integrate dA will be equal to integral of d v square by 2. Okay, so over here also, area is final velocity square minus initial velocity square divided by 2. So whether area is, sorry, whether acceleration is changing or not, total area is final velocity square minus initial velocity square divided by 2. Okay, any doubts till now? So we have completed the graphical analysis as well as the calculus-based analysis. Anything related to these two things? Anyone has any doubt or any issue, any problem? Tell me. How is x v square by 2? Where is x? What do you mean? See, the first line, right? This is area of the strip. Area of the strip. Okay, this is the area of the strip. Now, in this area, thickness is so less, I'll assume that acceleration is constant. Okay, if acceleration is constant, we have already derived that the area will be final velocity square minus initial velocity square by 2. Or you can say delta of change in v square by 2. Delta means final minus initial. Final velocity square by 2 minus initial velocity square by 2. So if thickness is very less, delta is replaced by d. Okay. D is very small change in v square by 2. And integral of anything of d is that thing only. So dx integral is x. D of v square by 2 integral is v square by 2. But then yes, I can understand this is not very intuitive. Counterintuitive it is. So this will come with the practice only. Okay. Anyone has any other doubt? Anyone has any other doubt? Okay, no doubts, doubtless. Fine. So let's take a few questions and then we'll start the, what is that? Relative motion. Okay. This one. All of you, this is a good opportunity for you to learn here itself. We are doing a lot of questions on calculus. Don't keep it for the later. And all of this is NCERT level. We haven't yet gone to the mains level. Remember that. V is velocity, okay? V is velocity. First one, if you are able to solve it, type it out. Ideally, you would have wanted x in terms of t, but problem is t is given in terms of x, right? So how will you solve it? If t is given in terms of x, how will you get the acceleration? How do you get velocity first if t is given in terms of x? Arya, how to get velocity if t is given in terms of x? If x is given in terms of t, you get dx by dt. Take a derivative of x with respect to time. Dx by dt is velocity. But t is given in terms of x. How to get velocity? Yes, Arya. No. There is no other formula. Same formula you have to use. Should I solve? Nobody else? Okay. All right. No one. How to get velocity if t is given in terms of x? All right. No one is able to do this. T is equal to ax square plus. See, I'm not interested in final answer. Okay. You tell me final answer is this, that is useless. Learn how to solve it. That is more important. T is equal to AX square plus BX. I will not be able to get DX by DT, but I'll be able to get DT by DX. DT by DX. This is what 2AX plus B. Fine. So I'll take inverse of this. DX by DT will be the velocity. Right? DX by DT is 1 by 2AX plus B. What? How, Arnav? Inverted, right? Second step. Are you differentiated, na? DT by DX. DT by DX is equal to A times. How you differentiate? X square. Then how will you integrate X? What do you get? Right? So 2AX plus B you will get. All right, so this is the velocity. Now what I have to do, if this is the velocity, I will have to differentiate it again. So dv by dt, everyone, what it is? Dv by dt minus of 2a divided by 2ax plus b whole square, okay, into dx by dt. Okay, I know 1 by 2ax plus b is velocity. This is minus of 2a v square, and dx by dt is also velocity only. So this will give me minus of 2a v cube. Okay, so that's why d. All right, everybody understood? See, all questions will not be same, right? We have to do different questions. And there will be millions of the varieties of questions. You can't mug up every type of question. You didn't get dv by dt step, derivative, differentiation of 1 by 2ax plus b. What it is? How will you differentiate? 1 by 2ax. If this is, let's say, y, then dy by dt is what? 2x plus b, sorry. There is a chain rule, okay? You differentiate it. What you do is that, assume this, I thought you would have done it. Okay. Assume this to be t. So dy by dt, first you do. This will be 1 by t then, right? So dy by dt will be minus 1 by t square. So this will be t square is this. This is dy by dt. Okay. Now, but I want to find out dy by dx. Dy by dx is dy by dt into dt by dx. Dy by dt is this. Dt by dx is 2a. Have you done chain rule in maths? In maths, you have done the chain rule or not? Same thing here. Looks like you haven't done practice of calculus. You haven't done the assignments. Anyways, do the next question, all of you. Next question is a lot simpler. Everyone try it. It's very simple question. What's the formula for average acceleration? What is the formula? No. What is the formula for average acceleration? Gurman, what is the formula? Correct. Final velocity minus initial velocity divided by the time taken. Right? Now do it. You don't need to have any integration differentiation here. Final velocity is what? When t is 5. Okay. Velocity at 5 seconds is v5. This will be 5 minus 5 square. That is minus 20. Velocity at 3 seconds, 5 minus 3 square. Is it how much? 5 minus 9 minus 4 meter per second. So average acceleration, final velocity is minus 20 minus of initial velocity minus 4 divided by time is what? 3 to 5. Time is 2 seconds. Okay. So average acceleration is minus 16 by 2. Minus of 8 meter per second square. Yeah, calculus is just like a tool. You don't need to use all the tools every time, right? Wherever screwdriver is required, you don't need to use plier, right? So you need to decide when to use calculus. Nobody can tell you that, okay, fine, in this question, use calculus. In this question, don't use calculus, right? It is your own judgment that you have to practice and evolve. But over here, I think it is direct formula. So always, you should first think directly how to get the answer. And then if something is changing, if acceleration is changing, right? And they are asking you something to, evaluate as such, then you have to, suppose I, in the same question, I ask you what is the displacement, then you need to integrate. Well, acceleration is not constant, but I am asking you what is average acceleration. Average acceleration is that there is a formula, final velocity minus initial velocity divided by 2, and that formula is valid for whether acceleration is constant or not. So I'm directly getting it. Why will I use calculus? Isn't it? Okay, I hope no doubts. Solve this one. Everyone, Okay, Gurman, Shitij, others. It's a simple question. Try doing it. Find its. Till now, nobody got it correct. And now you got hint, huh? But you got minus one, remember that. Next time also you'll get minus one if you're overconfident. Everybody? Okay, I can see everyone is making that error, which is started by, I'll not take names. So look at it, what they're asking. They're asking you to find speed. Can speed be negative? No, right? So minus 40 is not correct. 40 is correct. Even though you get minus 40. So area under 80 graph is change in velocity. It is not change in speed. You're getting velocity, not the speed. Okay. So this is, let's say, area A1. This is area A2. So A1 minus A2. Is final velocity minus initial velocity. A1 is 4 into 10. A2 is 4 into 20. Particle starts from rest. So U is 0. So this is V. V comes out to be minus 40 meter per second. And we are in a hurry to answer quickly. So we will say C is the answer. Okay. Save that extra 1 second to again check what is asked. So answer is D. Okay. Graphical question, simple AT graph. Area is change in velocity. Next up. Now I'm giving you questions on everything we have done till now. Before even starting the relative velocity, I'm giving you questions on everything that we have done. Okay. These are the simple, straightforward questions. All of you will be quickly answering it. Okay. C to definitely not correct because speed cannot be negative. What about D? D for Delhi. Time is going back in, right? Time has increased till here, till this point, time has increased. And then, you know, it is going back in time. Time cannot even be stationary. It can't even be 90 degree. It has to tilt a little bit. It has to travel forward. So both D and C, they are not correct. This one. Oshik has answered quickly. Others, what are you doing? Okay. I will put a poll for this. I'm giving you one more minute. Okay. Because there will be some difference between class 9th motion and class 11th motion, right? So don't expect that the difficulty level will be similar to what you have done in class 9th. You are in 11th now. So get rid of that mode, that thinking that, oh my God, it is difficult, different. It has to be. All right, so I'll launch a poll now. Poll, Yera poll. Tell me. Fine. I'm ending the poll now. This is what it is. And yes, answer is A. How it is A? Let me just tell you how you should arrive at the answer, okay? The final answer is not important. I'll tell you how to get to the answer. Now here you can see ball is bouncing after hitting the ground. So direction of velocity is changing or not? Direction of velocity is changing. All of you agree that the velocity direction is changing and it changes immediately. Okay, so if initially it is positive, after collision it should be negative or vice versa. So direction of velocity should be changing. And you can see in option B and D, the direction of velocity is not changing. It remains positive or it remains negative. So B and D you should eliminate. Okay, now it is two options. Okay, you have two options. All right. So based on these two options, you need to pick which one is correct. The A and C, you can see here, the only difference is there is a linear graph between velocity and height in C, and in A, there is not a linear graph. Okay. So you know that velocity, how it changes with the height, V square equal to, it is dropped, right? It is dropped. So initial velocity is zero. This is 2G into H. So you can see that it's not a linear relation. V square is proportional to its height. Okay. So that's why option A is correct. So you have to do only this much to arrive at the answer. Okay. Don't overdo things. But then you can analyze it further. For example, can you tell me when ball is dropped from the top, this is the graph for that or that is a graph for that? One or two? Which one? When ball is dropped from the top. It'll be one. You can see here, the height is D. height is d, velocity is zero, then it goes like this. When height becomes zero, velocity is maximum, and then it bounces off. So from this point, where it goes immediately? From this point, it goes to that point, which is A, or that point, which is B. Where does it go? From here. A or B? It goes to A. Because height will remain zero only. Immediately, height will not become D by 2. And then it moves up by a distance of D by 2. Okay. So like this, you can fully analyze also. But then if it is just about getting the answer, you can get it just by doing one step. Yes, Oshik, what happened? Quickly. Okay, next up, graph 1, velocity is reducing. Velocity is reducing. How can you say that? Velocity is not reducing. How can you say that? Velocity is 0 here. Velocity is on the y-axis. It goes like this. And it is maximum when it is about to hit. You're dropping something, when it is about to hit, velocity will be maximum, right? All right, so let us take up this one. I hope all of you are able to see it. Anyone? Maximum acceleration. Maximum, graphically, how you find where the acceleration is maximum? Velocity versus time. The slope is steepest. Wherever the velocity increases fastest, that is a maximum acceleration. Okay. So what is the acceleration between 0 and A? How much it is? Assume this is 20. It'll be 20 minus 0 divided by 20 minus 0. So this is 1 meter per second square. Acceleration of AB, how much it is? It is 0. Okay. Acceleration of B to C. velocity at C is 60 minus velocity at B is 20 divided by time. So 40 minus, this is let's say 30. This is how much? 4 meter per second square. Acceleration of CD, how much it is? Final velocity is 0. Initial velocity is 60. How much time? 80 minus 40. So this will be minus 60 by 40. So that is minus of 3 by 2 meter per second square. Okay. Fine. Acceleration at 40 second is not defined. Fine, Oshik. Left hand limit is different. Right hand limit is different. You cannot differentiate velocity there. If you're slightly this side, acceleration is something. Slightly the other side, acceleration is something else. Okay. We are assuming this to be 30. Okay. All right. So clearly option D is correct. Fine. B to C. Acha, by the way, one point I wanted to tell here. Suppose acceleration of C to D comes out to be minus 5 meter per second square. Then what is the maximum acceleration? 4 or this? Which one is maximum acceleration? Minus sign means what? Minus sign signifies what? It signifies direction only. Don't judge the magnitude by the sign. It has nothing to do with the magnitude. So when you're saying which one is higher, compare the magnitude. Okay. Compare the magnitude. So 5 is the maximum acceleration, even though you are getting minus 5. Right? All right. So we'll do a few more questions. This one. The nth second formula, just look at it. Nth second formula. No one? I'll just write down the nth second formula. Should I solve also? Or should I wait? Should I solve? Okay, should I solve, everyone? All right, so here the last second it traveled this much distance where h is the height, okay? So it is dropped, initial velocity is zero. So s nth is 9h by 25. This is equal to half of g times, g is the acceleration due to gravity. Now you can claim that acceleration is negative. So will be the 9h by 25, even this will be negative. So I'm keeping both as positive, okay? This will be your first equation. What could be the other equation? Because there are two variables, h and n, both are the variables. So what will be the other equation? Anyone? You can use s equal to ut plus half at square. If I put t equal to n, what will be s? If I put t equal to n, what will be s? S will be h, right? So h will be equal to u is zero. So half g n square, okay? Now they're asking you to find h, but it will be better if you find n first. So if you divide first equation from second, you'll get 9 by 25 is equal to 2n minus 1 divided by n square. So from here, if you solve this quadratic equation, you'll get n equal to 5 seconds. Okay. So once you get n equal to 5 seconds, h will come out to be half into, take g as 10, because I am saying so, right here g is 10, into n square, that is 25, that will be 125 meters. Everybody understood this? Everyone? Type it, any doubts, anything you want to discuss or ask. No doubts? Okay, we'll take one more question, then we'll take a break. After the break, we will take up the relative velocity then. Discussion. This one. Rectilinearly means it is straight line. Okay, rectilinearly means straight line. What is the formula for average velocity, everyone? Formula for average velocity. Average velocity, you're telling me average acceleration, Ansh. Average velocity, total displacement divided by total time. That is the average velocity. Now get it from here. Gurman got something. Oishik Shittij. Everybody should answer, okay? It's a simple question. Gurman, Oishik and Shittij, get the value of average speed. Average velocity you got, get the value of average speed now. Everybody else, what is the answer? When are your school starting? When are your, you don't know. No are enough, that's not. Okay. I think in NAFL and in NPS Yeshwantpur, some of the schools they have started. All right, so the answer is zero. Answer is A. How it is A? Because total displacement is zero. How to get total displacement from velocity? It is not a constant acceleration because dv by dt is not constant. So how to get the displacement? We'll use calculus because I know v should be equal to dx by dt. Whether acceleration is constant or not, v should be equal to dx by dt. You know, you can use calculus even when acceleration is constant. Forget about equations of motion. Okay. Once you are in that mode, you can use calculus approach everywhere. But then that will take some time. Just that I'm telling you that calculus approach is a generic approach. It is valid everywhere. So this is how you will integrate. Now, x is 0 initially, t is what? 0, 0, then t is 2 seconds, x, fine. So, x will be equal to 4 times t square by 2, 0 to 2, minus 3 times t cube by 3, 0 to 2, okay? So, this is 2t square. You'll get 2 times 2 square minus 0 square minus of 3 and 3 are gone. So 2 cube minus 0 cube. So this will be 2 into 2 square minus 2 cube. That is 0. So the displacement is 0. Displacement is 0. So average velocity will be 0. Total displacement divided by total time to 0 meter per second. Okay. Now, if somebody asks you find out the average speed, then what do you have to do? Any idea? Anyone? This is the average velocity. Find the displacement. Displacement by time is the average velocity. Average speed is distance by time. So, for that, you need to get the value of distance. How to get distance? Correct. Average is, you know, huh. So speed should always be positive. Okay. Speed should always be positive, but 40 minus t square can become negative. So basically I need to integrate this 40 minus t square. I have to take mod and then integrate this. So I need to check when it will become negative. So when it will become negative, when 40 minus 3t square is less than 0, or 4 minus 3t less than 0, or t is greater than 4 by 3 seconds. Okay, so this integral, I'll not solve it completely. Those who are interested, I'm just extending this question. So 0 to 4 by 3, you have to integrate 40 minus 3t square dt. Then next up, you have to integrate between 4 by 3 to 2. What you should integrate? Everyone, what do you have to integrate? 40 minus t square or what? You have to take mod of it. Between 4 by 3 and 2. So multiply that with minus 1 to make it positive. So now you have to integrate 3t square minus 4t dt. Okay. Once you integrate this, you will get the value of distance covered. That distance divided by 2 is the average speed. Okay. Answer, I don't know. I don't care. I'm just telling you how to solve it. So this is till now we have covered the graphical approach, calculus approach, algebraic approach, all kinds of approaches we have covered to analyze the motion in 1D. Okay, after the break we'll be taking up a new kind of scenario wherein two or three particles are moving together and there is a relative motion between them. It is like, for example, I am running behind the bus. Bus is also moving. So how much time I'll take to catch the bus? Bus might be accelerating. I might be accelerating. So things like that will be taken care of after the break. Fine. So right now it is 6:05. We will meet after 15 minutes, 6:20. Don't miss the last part. Come on time. It's very important section. We'll do it after the break. Okay. All right. Bye for now. All right, so assuming all of you are there. Everyone. All right. Someone left during the break. Oro. No, Oro is there. Anyways, we'll start. Okay, so let's continue. Write down relative motion. Oshik. Yeah. Somehow Oro and Oshik sound similar to me. I don't know. Yeah, but somehow. Initially, I was confused. Oshik and Oro, they are same. But then, yeah, of course, they are not. No, they are not same. Of course. All right, so write down relative motion. Here we will be talking about how objects are observed by an observer that himself or herself is moving. What does it mean? It means that if observer moves while looking or observing will the observer be able to see the true velocity of the object or not, the actual velocity? No, it won't be able to see the true velocity, right? Then it won't be able to observe. I'm writing it for the observer. Of course, it's a living being, but then it can be an object also, a sensor. So won't be able to observe the absolute velocity. Has it ever happened that you are on a train in a platform, okay, and then you realize that you have started moving? All right, but then immediately after a few seconds, you come to know that it is not you, it is the train next to you that is moving. Has it ever happened? Right, so this is one thing which you can observe. I mean, I have observed many a times. So, Aja, this thing you might have observed, everyone might have observed. Suppose you are on a moving train, okay? You know that the trees are at rest, okay? There is no mystery in that. Trees are at rest, Okay, suppose you don't know that trees will be at rest. Suppose you don't know. So how will you feel the trees are moving? In which direction? You'll feel as if trees are running behind you. Trees are going against your motion, right? So that is what you're observing. Forget about the truth. Truth, nobody knows, right? Absolute velocity doesn't even exist. Fine. So what we do in kinematics is whatever we observe, we analyze it, right? But over here, if observer is at rest on the ground, the observer is observing something, trees are at rest. And when observer starts to move, observer feels that trees are moving. So there are two different velocities for the same object. The tree's velocity was zero when observer is at rest. Tree's velocity is something when observer is moving. Okay, so what is going on? Here, observer is not observing the true velocity. Observer is observing the relative velocity. So basically what happens is that observer, write down, observes the world by subtracting his or her motion. From the world. So basically what happens is if velocity of observer is VO, this is, let's say, velocity of observer. Okay. And U is the velocity of object. Then what, when I say velocity of object, I mean true velocity. True velocity of object is U. True velocity of observer is V naught. So what observer will observe? Anyone? What observer will observe? U minus V. Observer will subtract. Observer will subtract his or her own velocity from the object the observer is observing. So when observer is observing trees, U is what? Velocity of tree was zero, right? So for trees, U is zero. So what observer will observe? Observer will observe zero minus V, that is negative of your own velocity. Right? So you will observe trees are going with minus V velocity. So if you're going like this, trees will be going backwards. This is what it is. Okay. And this is valid not only for motion in 1D, motion in 2D also, we'll be talking about relative motion. This is true there also. But you need to make sure that you are having vector subtraction here. This is not like you find the magnitude and subtract it. It's vector subtraction. Fine. Getting it, all of you? Let's take one quick example here. Suppose an object is going like this, 2 meters per second. This object and this is observer. Observer is moving like this, 2 meters per second. So what is the relative velocity of the object with respect to observer? What observer will observe? What velocity? Observer will feel as if object is at rest because distance between them won't change. Observer will feel that object is moving when object is either coming towards the object, observer, or going away from the observer. But over here, the distance between object and observer will not change because both are going together like this. So you'll feel as if velocity is zero. The best example is the Earth. You know with what velocity Earth is revolving around the sun? 12 kilometers every second. 12 kilometers per second, Earth is revolving around the sun. But you are not feeling anything. Two reasons. One is Earth doesn't vibrate while revolving around the sun. Second, you are moving with the Earth. So you don't feel. With respect to you, velocity of Earth is zero. Fine. All right, so let's take another example. Suppose this is the velocity of object, let's say 2 meters per second, and observer is going with 5 meters per second. So how the observer will feel object is going, in which direction, and with what velocity? Two minus five, which is minus three. So observer will feel as if object is going like this, 3 meters per second. You're assuming forward direction to be positive. So velocity coming out to be negative, meaning that it is going in the opposite direction. Everybody is clear, right? No doubts as such. No doubts. Okay, just one more question, then we will move ahead. Let's say the object is going like this, 2 meters per second, and the observer is going like that, 5 meters per second. So what is the velocity of the object which observer sees and in which direction? Assume right-hand side to be positive. Tell me what is the answer. That side is positive, as in 2 meters per second is positive. Everyone. So velocity of object is plus two. Velocity of observer is what? Velocity of observer is what? Minus five, right? So observer will see the world by subtracting his or her own velocity from everything it observes. So it is observing 2 meters per second, then observer has to subtract its velocity, which is minus five. Two minus of minus five, you will get 7 meters per second. Plus seven, it is coming. So you'll feel as if the object is going in the positive direction this way with 7 meters per second, even though its actual velocity is 2 meters per second. So this is a relative velocity concept simply explained for motion in 1D only. Everybody is clear about these basic observations? Everyone, please type in yes or no. Or if you have any doubts, please type in. I'm waiting for your doubts. Everyone, no DBTS. Okay, all right. Now you will see that it becomes little complicated that you subtract the velocity, take care of the sign convention and things like that. So there is one very simple way you can analyze the relative velocity. You will not find it in any textbook. So this is based on our own experience. I thought we could discuss that. It's fine. So because, you know, right now we are only dealing with velocity. What if there is relative acceleration also? What if velocity and acceleration both are there and in different directions? You'll go crazy. right? So there has to be a very simple way to deal with relative velocity. And this is what we are going to discuss next. But before even discussing the simpler way, you should understand the basics. So this is what the basics are. Anyways, so write down velocity. So the heading, you know, it's not part of any textbook as such, so we can have our own heading. So basically, I'm talking about here velocity or acceleration of approach and separation. So you will notice one very peculiar thing about motion in 1D for relative motion, that either object will be, you know, trying to separate from the observer, or object will be trying to come close to the observer. Only these two things can happen. Fine. There is no other thing that is possible. So since only these two things are possible, that either they are approaching or going away, so we'll use this to analyze the relative velocity. Okay. Concept is, I mean, the way we should, the way we understand this, very simple. So we'll keep it simple only. Think in a simple way, okay, all of you. Suppose these are the two points. Acha, by the way, you know, it is not written on the observer's hat that observer is observer. Anything can be observer. Even object can be observer. All right. So don't start finding, okay, which one is observer, which one is object. Not required. So suppose these are the two objects, A and B. Okay. A is going like this with velocity V1. B is going like this with velocity V2. The distance between them is L. So use your common sense. Tell me, what is the velocity of approach? With what velocity they are approaching each other? I'm not asking a relative velocity of one with respect to other. I'm asking you how fast they are approaching each other. Everyone, common sense. You can be wrong also. Acha, V1 and V2 both are positive. I mean, both directions are shown. I'm only talking about magnitudes here. I'll not consider signs here. Velocity of approach is sum of the velocity, right? Velocity of approach is equal to V1 plus V2. Simply, it is sum of the velocities, because A is trying to approach B with V1, B is trying to approach A with V2. So both are trying to approach each other, and total velocity with which the distance between them is decreasing is V1 plus V2. Both are adding each other. Distance of approach is how much? How much distance they will be covering in total? L. So time taken by them to cover the distance L is L divided by V1 plus V2. Okay, so very simple, right? Now let's take another example. Now we'll have acceleration also. This is A, that is B, distance between them is L, okay? This velocity is V1. This velocity is V2. Okay. Acceleration of A is this way, A1. Acceleration of B is this way, A2. Getting it? Now tell me, what is velocity of approach? How much it is? common sense, philosophy of approach, everyone. A is trying to approach B or trying to go away from B? Everyone. A is trying to approach B or trying to go away from B? I'm asking a simple question. A is trying to approach B or trying to go away from B? A is trying to go away. You're looking at acceleration or velocity? I'm talking about velocity. With respect to velocity, I'm talking about velocity of approach, right? So, A is trying to go away or towards B initially. It's trying to move towards B. If I just talk about velocity, it is trying to move towards B, isn't it? What about B? B is trying to move towards A or away from A? Look at velocity. Velocity I'm talking about. Forget about acceleration. Things are not clear. Everyone. Arnav, what is the velocity of approach? Suppose acceleration is not given. Now tell me. Acceleration is not there. Fine. Now tell me. A is trying to come closer to B. What about B? B is trying to come closer to A or going away from A? It is trying to go away. So net velocity of approach is what? Net velocity of approach is what? V1 minus V2. V1 is trying to decrease the distance. V2 is trying to increase the distance. So total net-net with what velocity their distances are decreasing? V1 minus V2. So this is velocity of approach. Okay. Now assume that they have acceleration. Let's say this is A1 and this is A2. Tell me, A1 is trying to decrease a distance or increase a distance? Look at A1. A1 only. Decrease, right? What about A2? A2 also same, right? So acceleration of approach is what? What is acceleration of approach? A1 plus A2. Okay. So you have velocity of approach, initial velocity of approach, and acceleration of approach. And distance of approach is what? L, initial distance between them, right? Now here is the power of this particular concept. The thing is that you can use S equal to UT plus half AT square for relative variables also. So distance of approach is L, velocity of approach is V1 minus V2, that into T plus half A1 plus A2 times T square. So using this equation, you can get directly the value of T for which these two particles will meet. These two particles may not meet if, let's say, V2 is very... No, they will meet because acceleration is favoring it. Fine. So you solve this differential equation. Sorry, you solve this quadratic equation. You'll get the answer for the time for which they will meet. So we'll take up another scenario. Then we'll see what to do next. All right. Everyone, draw this. There are two objects, A and B, distance is L. This is V1, V2, A1, A2. Okay. You need to just do these things. Find out velocity of approach. Find out acceleration of approach. And distance of approach. And then S equal to UT plus half AT square you have to use here. Everyone, do this. Velocity of approach is what? Minus of V1 plus V2. Both velocities are separating. Acceleration of approach, how much it is? A approach. A1 is trying to decrease the distance minus A2. Distance of approach is what? S approach. Is L. So I can write here that L is equal to minus of V1 plus V2 into T plus half A1 minus A2 times T square. Okay. All right. Now, if I ask you how much time it will take for separation to become 2L. Find out. I mean, just write down the equation. Don't solve it. Same conditions. How much time will it take for separation to become 2L? Now you have to find velocity of separation and acceleration of separation. Try doing it. Velocity of separation is what? Everyone? This was velocity of approach. You're talking about separation, right? From L, it is becoming 2L. Velocity of separation is what? V1 plus V2. Both velocities are trying to separate. Acceleration of separation? A2 minus A1. How much distance they have separated? In time t, what is the distance of separation? No. From L, it has become 2L. Distance of separation is L only. 2L minus L. Okay. So I'll be using s equal to ut plus half vt square. So L is equal to v1 plus v2 times t plus half of a2 minus a1 times t square. Now you might be wondering, how come if they are approaching, how come they can be separated? They can be anything depending on what is the value of a1, a2. Probably when you solve this, you will not get real values of t. Getting it? So you can solve it either ways, depending on question, of course. But have you understood how we use the relative motion concept here? Velocity separation, acceleration of separation. Everyone has understood? Type in yes or no quickly, then we can take up questions. Ask doubts, whatever doubts you have, don't hold it. We'll be taking questions, of course, on whatever we have discussed just now. It's not very simple to understand just like that, okay? Okay, so let's take questions now on the relative motion concept. So that elephant question, you remember this one? Okay, try doing it with velocity of approach concept, all of you. Try doing it with velocity of approach concept. There is no acceleration. Done. Try it, no hurries. You can take time. I don't remember the final answer. I will solve it step by step so that you understand the approach and separation concept. Can you find out what is the time B will take to catch C? How much time B will take to catch C? That is step number one, right? So between B and C, what is the velocity of approach? Anyone? Between B and C, if velocity of B is u, C is 10. What is the velocity of approach? Everyone answer it. B is running behind C with velocity u. C is going away with 10. So with what velocity B and C are approaching each other? Everyone answer it. I'm waiting for everybody's answer. I'll take your names then. Gurman, what it is? Oshik. Okay. Arya. Arabi. Aditi. Ansh. Priyam. Everybody. Ansh has answered. I'll not leave. Everyone must answer. At least those who have taken the names. Elephant B is going behind C with velocity u. C is going away with 10. With what velocity B is approaching C? That is relative velocity of approach. Velocity of approach is how much? Arabi, Aditi, Arya, I haven't got reply from you. Everybody else replied. Waiting for your reply. Quickly. Okay, Aditi answered. Arabi and Arya, what it is? Arabi, now you're only one. Am I audible, Arabi? No, not answer. Not looking at answer. I am asking you, velocity of approach is what? Between B and C. Between elephant B and elephant C, what is the velocity of approach? Arabi. Velocity of approach, I'm asking, you're telling me option A, B, C. What does it mean? I'm not asking you to solve it. What is a B is running with velocity u, C is running with velocity 10. What is the velocity of approach between B and C? Between B and C. Arabi, what it is? Okay, so you can see that B is going towards C with velocity u and C is going away from B with velocity 10. So approach velocity is u minus 10. Okay, with this velocity, B is trying to approach C. What is the distance of approach? Everyone, distance of approach is D. So how much time will it take for them to cover this distance? When B meets C, T is what? D divided by U minus 10. Okay. Right. Now I want to now analyze between A and C. Now you can see that between A and C, distance is increasing. From D, it has become 3D. So distance of separation is how much? From D, it has gone to 3D. So how much they have separated total? From D separation, the separation has increased. Between A and C, is it? Okay, from 2D. Between A and C, the distance was 2D. Now it has become 3D. So separation is D, right? By D units, they have separated further. The initial distance between them was 2D. Now it is 3D. So the separation is increased by d. So distance of separation is d between A and C. In same time, in this time only, t is d by u minus 10. What is the velocity of separation, everyone? Between A and C, what is the velocity of separation? Everyone, what is the velocity of separation between A and C? C is trying to go away with 10. A is approaching with 5. So with what velocity they are separating from each other? C is going away, A is following it up. So with what velocity they are going away from each other? 10 minus 5, right? 10 minus 5. So with 5 meter per second, they are moving away from each other. So 5 into t, 5 into t should be equal to distance of separation, which is d. Okay. So from here, you'll get u to be equal to 15 meters per second. Now, you know, you have learned something which is completely new. You have never seen relative velocity concept. So you'll feel a little bit of uneasiness that what is this new thing completely? Let me do it in an old fashioned way. But then don't, you know, get scared away by this concept. You know, there are many, many complicated questions that can be solved in a very simple manner by using velocity of approach and velocity of separation concept. Fine. So keep on solving questions on relative velocity and try to learn, struggle it through. Okay. Few of the students might be able to answer it quickly. Probably they have done it before. That is the only reason. So if you also spend, let's say, some time to struggle through it and understand, then you'll also start getting it. When exam happens, it doesn't matter how much one knows, how much one doesn't know. It is all about whether you are able to analyze the situation or not. Right now, probably some people might have mucked up a lot of concepts, or they might remember many things. They're able to solve it quickly. But when exam comes, after 2 years, the computer exam, knowledge doesn't matter. Your analytical mind will matter. So but then of course, little bit of concepts, you need to put it in your brain. Don't get scared away by this. Okay, this is very important concept. All right, we'll take up a few more relative velocity concepts question. This one. What is the condition for maximum value of acceleration A? Before you even start solving it, you need to first understand what is the condition when the acceleration will be maximum. What should happen for that? What is the condition? No, no, no. Forget about answer. I'm not interested in checking the answer. I want to know in what situation A will be maximum. What is that situation? Car should be able to catch up with the bike. But even if acceleration is less, if A is zero also, the bike is stationary, then also car will be able to catch the bike. Right? Isn't it? So, what is the condition for the maximum acceleration? Again, you understand? Even if acceleration is zero, car will be able to catch it. Then what is the condition for acceleration to be maximum? Not mathematical condition. Physically, what should happen? Time should be least. Okay. Time should be least. Don't you think when acceleration is zero, time will be lesser to catch? Time should be maximum. Maximum time it should take to catch. But what is the condition for it to catch? Condition for the car to catch the bike. You're not understanding what I'm asking basically. So let me twist the question a bit. Here it is. Suppose, see, car is velocity of bike must be lesser than the car at one approach speed. Okay. Understand? Listen here. All of you listen. Suppose, see, the car is going with constant velocity, whereas bike is accelerating. Velocity of bike is increasing. After every second, it kept on increasing. Fine. So tell me one thing. If the bike's velocity becomes equal to the car's velocity before even car reaches the bike, will they ever meet? Will they ever meet? No. Because acceleration of bike will keep on increasing. Once acceleration of bike is equal to the acceleration of car, bike will just run away because its velocity will keep on increasing beyond car's velocity also. So now tell me, what is the condition for maximum acceleration so that car can, you know, meet the bike? Tell me. No, you're telling me inequality. You're telling me bike must be lesser than car. You tell me equality. Equal to what? When S is zero, velocities are equal. Okay. So when car reaches the bike, their velocities are equal. So car has been just been able to reach the bike. That is a condition for the maximum acceleration. So again, I'll write here, for maximum acceleration, when car reaches bike, bike's velocity should be equal to the car's velocity . All of you understand this? Forget about solving 100 questions. One question you should, you know, do it systematically. It is equivalent to solving 10 questions. All of you understand this? Type in yes or no quickly. For max, if your acceleration is more than this acceleration, before even car reaches the bike, bike will run away. If your acceleration is more than this condition's acceleration. Okay. All right. Now I have got the condition for maximum acceleration. Now tell me initial velocity of approach. How much it is? Everyone. Initial velocity of approach. Velocity of bike was zero. initial velocity was zero. So initial velocity of approach is what? V. Everyone, it is V. Final velocity of approach is what? When they meet for maximum acceleration. Everyone. Both the velocities are equal finally. So velocity approach is what finally? Zero. It is zero. This is the strength of the velocity of approach concept. You have both initial and final velocities. And distance of approach is what? 100. And by the way, acceleration of approach, how much it is? With what acceleration they are approaching each other? What is A approach? Car doesn't have any acceleration. Bike has acceleration. What it is? Minus A. Very good. Very nice. So which equation should I use? Looking at these variables, which equation should I use to get the value of A quickly? V square equal to U square plus 2AS. This I will use. V is zero. Velocity of approach is zero. Initial velocity of approach is V square. This is minus 2A into 100, right? So A will be equal to V square by 200, all right? And V is given as 20, 20 square by 200, that is 2 meter per second square. So you can see that in one step, you get the answer by using velocity of approach concept. Otherwise, if you try to solve it using step-by-step approach, okay, fine, bike will move ahead by X. So car will have to travel 100 plus X. And then their velocity should be equal finally. Get the value of time, distance. It'll become a mess. Everyone appreciates. I mean, I have written here multiple steps. But then many steps are redundant. At the end, you can solve it in a single steps. Everybody understand? क्या तू ड्रॉइंग ऑफ कार इज नॉट गुड दिस इट्स अ बस ठीक है लुक लाइक अ बस ना ठीक है अर्नफ नाउ टेल मी इज इट क्लियर टू एवरीवन सो एस अप्रोच इज अ स्टार्टिंग डिस्टेंस बिटवीन द टू ऑब्जेक्ट यस डिस्टेंस ऑफ अप्रोच इज हाउ मच डिस्टेंस दे हैव कम क्लोजर टू ईच अदर वॉट एवर वॉज द initial distance between them, that much distance they have completed to meet, right? So whatever was the separation initially, that much is the approach if they are meeting. If suppose from 100, it has become, distance become 30. So what is the distance of approach? From 100, the distance between them become 30. Distance of approach is what? 100 minus 30. They have covered 70 meters. If final distance is 30 between them, they have covered 70 meters to approach each other. Then distance of approach is 70. Okay, so let us see what other. This one. These are, little tricky questions, understand? And I'm not expecting that you guys will be able to solve it, okay, frankly. Because if I just do simple question, you'll be able to solve it, you'll not learn anything. So I've taken tricky questions so that you struggle through it, and then you learn something new out of it, okay? Try attempting this. Okay, anyone? All right, no hurries. Okay, you got final answer. Let me check. Again, final answer I don't have. We'll discuss the solution, don't worry. By the way, the first chapter is, the kinematics chapter 1, motion 1D is over. All right, so you can solve any question from anywhere now, as long as it is motion 1D chapter's question. Should I do it now? All right, so let us first analyze the question. Forget about solving it and getting the answer. Okay, that's not important. Train starts from the station with constant acceleration. So what is given is that it starts. Starts means initial velocity is zero. And acceleration is given to us about the train. Passenger arrives the station 6 seconds after the end of the train has left. After 6 seconds, the passenger comes. So by the time, train will move ahead and will gain some speed also. Right? Now, what is the least constant speed at which passenger can run and catch the train? Fine. So, situation is like this. This is, let's say, train's rear end. This is the passenger. Okay. This is train. So, let's say this is T and this is passenger P. Okay. The acceleration of the train is given as 0.4 meter per second square. Fine. The velocity of the train is not given, as in we need to find out, because this is not the initial velocity of train. This is the velocity when passenger has arrived at the platform. That is 6 seconds after the train has started. So velocity of passenger is not given to us. That is what we need to find out actually. So I'll keep that as V, and this is velocity of train is U. Okay. Hold on. Wait. So the distance of approach is, let's say, L. Now L is what? L is a distance traveled by the train in the 6 seconds. So L is equal to half into 0.4 into 6 square. UT plus half AT square for the train. How much it is? 7.2 meters. So L is 7.2. Okay. And what is Shitij? While I'm speaking, don't type. It distracts. And I think I've told you several times. Okay, then I can't keep on checking messages and then keep on writing on the screen also. Got it? Take care of that. All right, so now what is this velocity? This velocity is after 6 seconds, because I'm analyzing the situation after 6 seconds. Fine. So V is equal to U plus AT I'll use. So this velocity is 0.4 into 6. So that is 2.4 meter per second. All right. So this velocity is 2.4 meter per second. There are two situations here. Situation number one, train started and then 6 seconds has gone. That is situation number one. And then in situation number two, passenger arrives and then running behind the train. So this is a situation number two in front of you. Everybody is clear about it, everyone? Everyone is clear. The distance between passenger and train will be 7.2. The velocity of train at this situation is 2.4. Acceleration is constant throughout, that is 0.4 meter per second square. Everybody is clear? Now tell me, what is the condition for least speed V with which passenger should run to catch the train? What is the condition for that to happen? When passenger is able to catch the train, their velocities become equal. If before even passenger catches the train, if train's velocity becomes higher, train is accelerating. It will just move forward. Passenger won't be able to catch it. Fine. So the minimum speed should be that when the passenger reaches the train, their velocity become equal. And because of that, you know, the final velocity of approach, how much? Final velocity of approach when passenger meets the train. Zero, right? Their velocities are equal. Initial velocity of approach is what? Initial velocity of approach. Everyone. What is the initial velocity with which train and the passenger are trying to approach each other? Waiting for everybody's answer now. Okay. Passenger is moving. Passenger is moving with V. Train is moving with 2.4. What is the velocity of approach? It is V minus 2.4. See, it is very simple. Apply your common sense, it'll come out. Passenger is trying to approach, train is trying to go away. So with what velocity they are trying to approach? V minus 2.4. Okay, keep it that simple. Don't complicate in your head. It is straightforward. Fine. So this is the situation. Distance of approach, how much? 7.2 meters. And acceleration of approach, how much? 0.4 meter per second square. This guy, passenger, has no acceleration. Train is accelerating but going away. So approach acceleration is minus of 0.4. Now I'll use V square equal to U square plus 2AS. V square is 0 square. U square is V minus 2.4 whole square. Okay. Minus 2, as in minus comes because of 0.4. 2AS 7.2. From here, you directly get the value of V. All right. Don't you think it's a simple method? If you understand it, you'll be able to get the answer in a single step. Otherwise, the question can be a lot more. I mean, this will make you write many steps. I hope this is clear to everyone. Okay. In case, I mean, it is perfectly right to feel that it is difficult. If I would have been in your place, I would not have understood the first time. Okay. So what I would have done, I would have gone back and watched the recording of the relative velocity concept again. Sit with paper and pen, and I'm sure little bit of effort you'll make, you'll be able to get it. It's not something which is out of the world. Okay. Fine. One last question we'll take. This one. solve it. Last question for today. Just write down the equation, that is enough as of now. Step number one is draw the diagram to visualize what is happening. Straight line, motion is straight line it is. What is this velocity u? This velocity is just sufficient for it to reach the top of the tower. Okay. So top of the tower, if it can just reach, final velocity at that point should be zero. So V zero U square minus 2G into 90. Okay. So U is equal to root over 180 into G. Let's say this is 10. Okay. So you'll get root over 1800. Don't simplify it. Keep it like this. So now velocity is known to you. Okay. 2 seconds later, a stone is dropped. So you need to find out where this first stone is after 2 seconds. After 2 seconds, suppose it reaches here. So how much is this distance? How to get that? This distance is, let's say, h. Okay. So I will be using s equal to ut plus half a t square. So s equal to u into 2 minus half into g, let's say 10, into 2 square. So this will give me the value of h. So now the stone is dropped from here, and this is another stone. This distance is 90 minus h. I need to find out how much time they will approach towards each other. They will meet, basically. For that, I need to know what is this velocity. Initial velocity of approach will come from its velocity at height h. That you will get from v is equal to u plus at. So v is equal to root of 1800 minus g is 10 into 2. Okay. This is your velocity v over here. Okay. So velocity of approach, initial velocity of approach is what, everyone, in terms of v and u and everything, tell me what is velocity of approach initially. This one is dropped. It is just dropped. initial velocity of the top stone is zero. Velocity of approach is what? Velocity of approach is V. See, this V is going towards the first stone. Got it? Acceleration of approach, how much it is? Everyone, acceleration of approach. Acceleration of this stone is G downwards. Acceleration of that stone is G downwards. So acceleration of approach is? Other stone has zero velocity, initial velocity. After 2 seconds, it is dropped. It is not thrown. Acceleration of approach is zero. Both accelerations are same. Same direction. It is zero. Acceleration of approach is zero. So this is something amazing. It will look as if it is going with constant velocity because acceleration is zero, relative acceleration. So basically V into T should be equal to 90 minus H. From here, you'll get time when they will meet. 90 minus H divided by V. Constant velocity. Relative velocity is constant. Alright guys, so that's it from my side today. It got extended a little bit. Okay. So many new things we have done. In case you are feeling that some concept was very difficult and I can understand it is not easy to understand in one sitting. It's not like your class 9th and 10th. Go back, watch the recordings, solve questions, okay? Solve a lot of questions. Make sure that you do these chapters while I'm teaching. If you finish it off from your side, you'll never have to go back and revisit them again. Okay, finish it off. School level, though, you'll take care of. I don't have any problem with it. You'll be able to do pretty well in school. The main issue will be competitive exams. So that's why we are doing higher order questions. Okay, so when you see the school level question, you'll see them that they're very easy and you'll be able to solve them easily. So make sure you do a lot of practice on the competitive exam front and do it in such a way that you don't have to do it again later on. Otherwise, it will just pile up. It will create a lot of trouble later on. All right. So that's it from my side. We will meet again next week. Take care. Bye for now.